The number of new coronavirus infections in India has jumped by 18%, with 45,576 new cases recorded in the past 24 hours. This is according to the government data. Now, yesterday it was 38,617 new cases and 474 deaths. That takes the overall figure to 89,58,483 since the outbreak in January. Up to 585 people died of the disease since yesterday. The overall number till now is 1,531,578. But the good news is that over 1 million daily tests have been conducted on November 18th after 5 days. So total tests conducted in the last 24 hours is 10,28,203. And you can see that the curve shows a downward turn. Now, let's take a look at which are the five states which have reported the highest number of cases in last 24 hours. Delhi, they're leading, and that is the reason why that the chief minister held an all-party meeting today. Kerala on number two, Maharashtra there on number three, West Bengal on number four, and Haryana there on number five. And Haryana is seeing a spike after schools and colleges were opened there. Teachers and students have reported positive there. Now, let's take a look at the top five states which have reported the highest number of deaths. Delhi has reported 131 deaths in the last 24 hours. This is the maximum reported till now. Maharashtra has reported 100, West Bengal 54, Punjab 31, and Haryana 30 deaths in 24 hours. Now, another important news that has come from the ICMR is that they say that indiscriminate use of plasma therapy is not advisable. They have released an advisory saying convalescent plasma therapy, or the CPT as they call it, or passive immunotherapy has been tried in the past for treatment of many viral infections, and benefits of CPT in improving the clinical outcomes, reducing the severity of the disease, duration of hospitalization, and reducing mortality in COVID-19 patients are dependent on the concentration of specific antibodies in the plasma that could neutralize the effects of SARS-CoV-2. Now, ICMR conducted an open-label phase 2 multi-center randomized control trial in India across 39 private and public hospitals. Now, after that, they have concluded that plasma therapy did not lead to reduction in progression of severe COVID-19 or any reduction they feel in mortality. Now, this they found after they saw that the group that received plasma did not show any significant difference from the group that did not receive plasma. Now, this is one of the world's largest trial on plasma therapy. Now, let's move on to the big news. World is racing towards a safe and effective vaccine, and there are multiple candidates in various countries that are front runners. Pfizer, Moderna, and Sputnik V have already shared their efficacy results with the world, and now we await results from Oxford vaccine. And meanwhile, the race for vaccine development in India is also heating up. India will be releasing results in a month. It is believed that Serum Institute vaccine, which is being developed along with the University of Oxford, will give India vaccine efficacy results in hopefully a month. Now, five vaccine candidates are in various stages of development in India. India is examining logistics of Pfizer and Moderna vaccines. Also, they require cold storage, and logistics are being looked into for Moderna and Pfizer vaccines. Now, if you look at the efficacy claims of the top vaccines till now, which have been published or shared with the world, Pfizer claims a 95% efficacy, Moderna 94.5%, and Sputnik V, which is the Russian vaccine, has claimed 92%. These are the three vaccines that have shared with the world what their efficacy rate is. And now we are awaiting the Oxford vaccine result, which is also a front runner. Now, Pfizer vaccine says that it has no safety concerns, and it has a 95% efficacy rate, and it has been found to be consistent across different ages and ethnicities as well. And it says that it has the required 2 months of safety data and would be applying for the emergency US authorization. In fact, they are claiming that very soon, which is probably by Christmas, they should be able to provide the vaccine or deliver the vaccine. Now, let's take a look at what the CEO of BioNTech has said. He has claimed that if all goes well, I could imagine that we gain approval in the second half of December and start deliveries before Christmas, but really only if all goes positively. So there is a rider added to it, but still, Christmas is the time, before Christmas is the time that they're saying they might be able to give some sort of deliveries in US and Europe. Now, if you look at Moderna, Moderna has claimed that it is 94.5% effective, and it is based on a technology that we call mRNA or the messenger RNA, which is being used for the first time to build an approved vaccine. It does require minus 20 degrees Celsius as the temperature to be stored, but has a shelf life of up to 30 days. Now, it is an expensive vaccine for India at $37.50 as the price. Now, that is a bit expensive for India, which never takes a very expensive vaccine. Now, if you look at the University of Oxford, if you look at that, because they are also conducting trials in India along with Serum Institute. Now, they have confirmed that COVID-19 vaccine that they are developing with AstraZeneca has produced strong immune responses in older adults in early study. Now, these results have been published in Lancet today. And they say that they have generated robust immune responses in adults ages of 18 to 55. Now, their study involved 560 adults, and these included 240 adults who were over the age of 70. Now, we are still awaiting late-stage trial results to see if the efficacy of this vaccine is at par with Moderna and Pfizer. Now, to talk about all these vaccines and the hopes that we have with us and whether all this is overhyped, because we really need to hold our horses there, we have Professor Dr. Anita Ramesh Chandra joining us there. She's a specialist in clinical trials and new drug launches, and she's been a principal investigator for more than 20 trials in India. Joining us also is Dr. Rajiv Seth. He's a senior pediatrician and medical director of Child Health and Development Center in New Delhi. Thank you very much, Dr. Seth and Dr. Chandra, for joining in this conversation. You know, but as I was saying, you know, all these headlines make us so hopeful about a vaccine. But what do you believe, Dr. Anita? When can India see a vaccine? Because the hopes from these Western vaccines might be a little too much for India to have right now.
Yes, I agree with you. These international vaccines, which are coming from Pfizer, BioNTech, which is a US and a German collaboration, Oxford, AstraZeneca, which is again a United Kingdom-based vaccine, and even the Moderna, which is a US-based vaccine. So they will be expensive. And many of them are mRNA vaccine, which needs a very cold temperature of minus 70 and minus 20 for Moderna. So that may not be a very good option as far as India is concerned. And you all already mentioned the cost will be quite high. So what India is now looking into is that, and we have done quite well in vaccines in the previous, our colleague will tell you, in the pediatricians, that the children immunization nationally is running very well. So what we at this point of time, India is looking at into Atmanirbhar Bharat, or the homemade vaccine or India made vaccine. So if you take the India made vaccine, one is the Bharat Biotech and collaboration with the ICMR, who is making the Covaxin. The vaccine is finished phase two, waiting for phase three study, and thereafter we can come with the results, and the company is hopeful. Next is the Zydus vaccine, which is also an India made vaccine, is already finished phase two and going for phase three study. The other one, you heard initially that the Sputnik vaccine has already come to India, and Dr. Reddy's in collaboration is getting into the study so that we can use it in India. And also mentioned by you, the Oxford AstraZeneca in collaboration with Serum Institute in Pune is making the other Indian vaccine. So what the country at this point of time needs in a robust vaccine, which will give immunity. At the same time, it will comply with the things in India, particularly the temperature, because you know different varieties of temperature all over. It will help in the distribution, and we need mass and millions of production to meet the country's need. So that's what we are looking at.
All right. Dr. Seth, also a point over there about the, you know, though most of these vaccines are claiming brilliant results as far as ethnicity is concerned, you know, and they are claiming all age groups are seeing efficacy, and so are all ethnic groups. But when these vaccines come to India, they will have to be tested on Indians as well. Isn't it so?
Oh, Absolutely. I mean, as you know, we need Indian trials, and the Sputnik vaccine is being tested. The Russian vaccine is being tested by Dr. Reddy's lab. But I think I'll bet myself for Indian vaccines, especially by the ICMR, Government of India, and the Bharat Biotech collaboration, and the Zydus vaccines, because these vaccines are not only going to be cheaper, but will also be stable, and cold chains can be maintained. You know, they just need 2 to 8 degrees, while the other vaccines, the Pfizer vaccine, needs minus 70 degrees of storage. And same is true for some other international like Moderna. So, and these vaccines, the international, as Dr. Anita mentioned, are very expensive. We need to also ensure that everybody, at least the high risk and the senior citizens, get it in the first phase, and others get it, you know, who really need it. And we have, you know, 1.3 billion, you know, population. So we do have logistic challenges as well. But I think by February 2021, it is expected the ICMR, Bharat Biotech vaccine, which is already advanced phase 3 trial, will be in a stage where it will be rolled out and implemented. So we are very hopeful about that. But one thing I want to just point out, that vaccinations alone should not be the hope. People should realize this is a one very important strategy, but nobody should be should discard all the COVID precautions. It is, vaccine is only going to complement that. So absolutely, our social distancing norms, our masks, hand washing, sanitizations, all we'll have to maintain. Absolutely. So this is a message that I really want to pass to our Indian colleagues and friends and the entire communities, that we are very hopeful that vaccine is going to be launched.
Right, absolutely. And we keep saying that, you know, if you follow those guidelines, it's as good as a vaccine. You will be safe and protected. But Dr. Chandra, just before we go, you know, I want to just throw a light on the efficacy results. Now, anything above 90 is, I mean, brilliant. I mean, we weren't even expecting that. Most of us were expecting a 50 to 60% efficacy. But it seems now that many front runners in India as well might start reporting the same kind of results, because we are seeing this trend of 90% and above.
Yes, you are correct. See, the Pfizer vaccine, when they gave it on 43,000 people, only 170 people developed corona positive. So that makes the figures 95. Whereas for Moderna, it is 94.5. And Moderna also showed that in all age groups, and particularly the elderly, were positive. Yes, we can expect that the Indian vaccines from Zydus, Bharat Biotech, Serum Institute is going to produce the same results. But one thing is that you have already mentioned earlier, ethnicity. We need to see how India produces the antibodies, how long this antibody is going to last. How that is the longevity. It is that, suppose the antibody titer dips down, for that report we do not know which vaccine gives you stable immunity. So that needs to be seen. So in India, we need to see how much of antibodies Indians are producing and how long these antibodies are lasting, because then only the coronavirus vaccine gives you lasting result. So these two big questions are not answered yet. But yes, I am also very hopeful that India will make it the best vaccines in the world.
Right, absolutely. Thank you very much, doctors, for joining in this conversation. So as our doctors are telling you, keep your hopes high, but don't be impatient about it. And the most important thing, along with the vaccines, is the fact that you already have something which is very effective, and that is mask, social distancing, and maintaining hygiene. We're going to take a very quick break now. When we come back, we get you the latest updates from across the world and also answer your questions. Welcome back, and now it's time to answer your questions. And joining me right now is Dr. Sameer Gupta. He's a cardiologist at Metro Hospital. Thank you, Dr. Gupta, for joining in. Now, let's listen into the first question that has been sent by Rama Thakur from Noida.
I just want to ask, is it safe for me to donate blood during coronavirus pandemic?
Dr. Gupta.
I'm sorry, I did not understand the question.
She's asking if it's safe to donate blood during this pandemic.
You know, that's a great question, and if it's safe, you know, the pandemic is, I think, now reached community spread. So we obviously have to be cautious when we go out. And the act of donation of either plasma or blood is a very noble thing. and the pandemic should not really deter you from doing that. You should donate blood, but wear all the masks and or take all the precautions when you go there. And don't be afraid of doing this noble deed, because you're probably going to save somebody's life when you do that. So please go ahead, wear the mask, wear the shield, go to the healthcare facility and donate blood.
Right. Let's take the second question, which has been sent by Hemant from Delhi.
Hi, am I at risk for serious complication from COVID-19 if I smoke cigarette?
Well, doctor, he's asking if his serious complication risk is more because he smokes cigarettes.
You know, so yes, you know, the virus usually affects the lungs, and that's the major organ which is infected. And you know, though there have not been clear data for this, you know, when you smoke cigarettes, your lungs usually get weak and they get compromised. And add an infection on top of that, and now it's a recipe for more lung problems, so to say.
Absolutely.
So yes, if you do smoke cigarettes, your problems, your infection is going to be on compromised lungs, and that can increase the seriousness of the lung infection. And we are seeing some of that anecdotally amongst patients who are coming with smoking cigarettes. They usually have a more extensive lung involvement because they cannot really fight the virus per se. So yes, I think it's a good time to quit smoking.
Right, absolutely. I was just going to say that maybe pandemic is the right time to quit smoking, something that I'm sure a lot of people have been thinking about for a very long time, but they do not take that plunge. Thank you very much, doctor. Thank you for answering these questions. Now it's time to salute our COVID warriors, Corona warriors. An Anganwadi Sevika from Maharashtra has set an example by performing her duty in the most challenging circumstances during COVID times. While tribals living in far-flung hilly areas stopped coming to the Anganwadi fearing COVID-19, Relu Vasave helped them by rowing across a river for 2 hours to reach them and help them.
Anganwadi Sevika Renu Ramesh Vasave is a hero these days, as the nationwide lockdown was imposed and the fear of getting the coronavirus kept tribals from the hilly tracts of Nandurbar district from coming to the Anganwadi. The 27-year-old rode across the mighty Narmada for 2 hours and travelled 18 hours to deliver food and medicines. Since April, she's been going by boat 5 days a week to the inaccessible hilly areas of the Satpura Mountains to ensure that children there get the government's nutrition supplements and expectant mothers get proper guidance.
Koi bhi labharti ahar se vanchit na rahe, isliye main khud hi nav mein poshak ahar lekar jati hu. Kabhi kabhi to jakar wapas aane mein 18 ghante lag jate. Kaam kathin hai, lekin apni zimmedari nibhana hai.
Delivering resources to tribals in the hilly terrain of Nandurbar district of Maharashtra in Akkalkua and Dhargaon is a task that involves challenging tasks like crossing the river Narmada by boat. Her teacher husband Ramesh helped her with the boat. Soon another colleague joined in.
कुछ ऐसे इलाके हैं कि वहाँ जाने के लिए रास्ते नहीं हैं. इसके बावजूद भी यहाँ की जो हमारी आंगनवाड़ी ताई है, रेलू ताई, जो काम कर रही है, यह काम सबके लिए एक मिसाल बन चुकी है.
Another Anganwadi Sevika, Sangeeta Dilwar Vasave, is also emulating Renu's example to reach out to the poorest and deprived sections of society under the same Integrated Child Development Services scheme in inaccessible areas.
There are about 1,08,000 Anganwadi centers in Maharashtra and close to 2,00,000 Anganwadi Sevikas who often go way beyond the call of duty to ensure that the most underprivileged sections of society, including children and women who are pregnant or are breastfeeding, have access to the most basic interventions on healthcare and nutrition. In Mumbai with Sunil Singh, Saurabh Gupta, NDTV.
Well, Corona warriors like these, they deserve all our respect. That's all we have for you in this show. We're going to join tomorrow again as we bring you the latest updates on coronavirus. Thank you.